Hachette Audio presents The Midnight Ride, written by Ben Mezrich, read by Corey Carthew. For my dad and mom, for being my first readers and my biggest supporters, but mostly for making me read two books a week when I was a kid before I was allowed to watch TV. Prologue. And behold, there arose a great tempest in the sea. The sensation was sudden and unexpected, so wild and intense and ferocious that Robert Bobby Donati actually gasped out loud. He could feel, really feel, the wooden deck rising up beneath his feet as the massive waves crashed against the stern of the reeling boat. He could see the dark, violent storm clouds billowing over the shattered mast as the bow careened toward the jagged rocks that would surely kill them all. He could hear the screams of the huddled passengers behind him, most caught up in mindless panic, some still holding oars or reaching up to desperately try to fix the mainsail, frantically trying to do something, anything, save for one man, in the center of the deck who peered out at the storm with a calm patience that could only be described as Christ-like. Because, well, and then Bobby's own voice tore him out of the moment, his thick Boston accent sounding vaguely tinny in his ears. "Get over here and help me get this off the wall." Bobby stepped back, almost surprised to feel marble beneath his leather police boots, rather than the damp wooden slabs of a 17th century sailing vessel. The boat and the waves and the storm weren't any less impressive because they were behind thick glass, embraced by a 5-foot-high gilded frame that looked like it must have weighed 50, 60 pounds. Bobby wasn't sure what had made him stop in front of that particular painting as he'd made his way across the darkened gallery. The lavishly decorated Dutch room was lined with masterpieces, gratuitously ornate frame after frame speckled along the embroidered walls, beneath candelabras and chandeliers dripping tears of crystal, as old and sad as the silken drapes hanging by the arched windows that overlooked the courtyard two floors below. But for whatever reason, the boat had called out to him, and Bobby's inner voice had joined right in for the chorus, despite every rational bone in his body telling him that it was the wrong thing at the wrong time, that the smart, cautious, and safe way forward was to stick to the plan. Bobby had never been able to ignore that damn little voice. He glanced over toward his partner, standing halfway across the gallery. 4 inches taller than Bobby and 20 pounds heavier, Richie Gustiano looked ridiculous in his uniform, which was two sizes too small, and bulging so much in the middle, Bobby was worried the shiny brass buttons running up the center might fly off at any moment. Worse, Richie's mustache was hanging half off his upper lip, and his hat was on backward. The only thing about him that looked real was his badge, which thankfully had been more than enough to get them from their red hatchback parked in an alley a block away and into the museum through the side door. "You hear me?" Bobby asked, and then repeated himself louder. "Get over here and help me with this."
"Are you serious?"
Richie finally responded, the mustache dancing in tune to an accent even heavier than Bobby's own. "We ain't even supposed to be in here." That was true. Richie might have been big, but he wasn't stupid. Well, he was big and stupid, but the plan had been simple enough that even Richie could follow it without so much as a dress rehearsal. Contract gigs were often like that. Every step spelled out in intricate detail, paint by numbers. All you had to do was keep your brush within the lines. Bobby turned back to the storm and the waves and the boat. "Yeah, I'm serious."
"This ain't the job,"
Richie tried again. "Yeah," Bobby responded, but he was already reaching for the frame. Once that damn little voice started speaking, Bobby had never been very good at keeping the brush between the lines. Lack of impulse control. That's what the teachers and the priests and the social workers who were eventually called in had called it when Bobby was growing up in East Boston. Sometimes he just did things. probably the reason, by the age of 51, his arrest record was as long and varied as his debt ledger. Bobby grinned as he drew his box cutter down the length of the canvas that was now splayed out on the floor in front of him. The feel of the blade against the painting was strange and unique. The chips and dust from the paint sprayed up against his gloved fingers, filling him with a sense of gravitas. He knew that paint was old, even older than the building around him, which itself looked like some sort of Venetian palace that had been airlifted out of 19th century Italy and dropped into a leafy suburb of Boston. But it wasn't just the age of the canvas, already halfway out of the gilded frame and beginning to curl up at the edges, like a bit of a newspaper held too close to a flame. Bobby knew that the decision he had made wasn't just spontaneous. It was, quite possibly, historic. He kept his knees steady against the bottom of the frame as he worked, ignoring the beads of sweat dripping down the back of his neck and staining the stiff collar of his borrowed police uniform. He could hear Richie's grunts as the bigger man worked on his own painting a few feet away on the floor. A much smaller frame, maybe 2 feet wide and tall, the canvas depicting some sort of 17th century parlor scene, involving a guy with a stringed instrument, two women, and a piano. It hadn't taken much to convince his partner to join in on the fun once they'd gotten the big one off the wall. Richie had always been more of a follower than most of the hoods Bobby had grown up with on the streets of Revere, which was why Bobby had tapped him for the job in the first place. No matter how simple a gig looked on paper, there was always the possibility of unexpected complications. And the last thing you needed when things went off script was a partner who liked to think for himself. As Bobby slid the box cutter down toward the final corner of his own canvas, he finally surveyed the room around them. Off script was an understatement. It wasn't just the painting of the boat and the one Richie was digging into. There were now a half dozen empty frames splayed out across the gallery, each beside a little pile of shattered glass. Some of the canvases were already rolled up and piled in a corner by the door, while others were still spread out near where they were working. Bobby didn't have tubes to put them in, but he had plenty of tape and zip ties in his duffel bag, which was just outside the Dutch room, in the second floor hallway leading to the rest of the museum. Tubes would have been better. Christ only knew how much these things were actually worth. But the tape and the ties would have to do. This wasn't Bobby's first art heist, though it was certainly his strangest, mainly because it wasn't really supposed to have been an art heist at all. But he'd stolen paintings before, and he knew that art this old often went for millions. Then again, with paintings like this, it wasn't so much about how much they were worth. It was more a question of finding someone willing to pay for them. Even the most eccentric billionaire couldn't exactly hang a Rembrandt on his living room wall. But a little after 1 a.m., dressed as a cop working a box cutter through the last few inches of the border of a 400-year-old painting, Bobby didn't concern himself with potential next steps. One of the benefits of acting on impulse was you really got to feast on the moment. And looking across the violated gallery, it was clear that Bobby and his partner had served themselves quite a buffet. Bobby actually felt bad for the feds who would undoubtedly try to piece together what was now a chaotic crime scene. To be fair, even before Bobby had deviated from the plan, none of it had really made much sense. Case in point, the two security guards who had first let them in the side door after seeing their badges, who were now taped up and handcuffed in a boiler room 3 floors below. If it had been up to Bobby, he would have taken the box cutter to them first, because he was a pro, and pros didn't leave witnesses. Then there was the amount of time they'd already spent in the museum. A quick glance at his watch told him they'd already been there an hour, an insane amount of time. Though in this, Bobby only had himself and his impulsive nature to blame. If he'd followed the plan, they'd have been in and out in minutes. But despite how confusing it would look to the feds, Bobby wasn't concerned about the time, any more than he was worried about the security cameras they had passed on their way from the basement, where they'd taped up the security guards, to the second floor of the gargantuan building. The security system was nearly as dated as the gallery around him. On the way out, they'd have no trouble grabbing the tapes from the VCR in the first floor security booth. Likewise, even if they'd spent...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.